Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 5853 in the name of Claire Adamson on Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month 2022. Debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And with that, I call on Claire Adamson to open the debate for around 7 minutes. Ms. Adamson.
Officer, it is a privilege to open this debate to mark Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month in our Parliament, and how wonderful it is to see the gallery bedecked in purple by supporters this evening, and it's great to be back in person for this sixth debate marking Awareness Month. Indeed, it's a testament to the extraordinary efforts of the campaigners, many of whom are in the gallery, that we can now say this is an annual event. Yes, certainly.
Michelle Thompson.
Thank you very kindly for that. I simply wanted to put it on the record that I note the presence of my constituents, Wendy and Ian Thompson, who tragically lost their daughter at a very similar age to the age of my daughter now, and note that I applaud and salute their bravery and efforts in cascading, getting information out there about this tragic disease. Thank you.
Claire Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I welcome that intervention from my colleague. What has always struck me about this debate is the number of MSPs, as just been demonstrated, with a personal or immediate knowledge of this cancer through a family member, friend, loved one or constituent. I wish to send my best wishes to John Scott, former Deputy Presiding Officer, whose own account of his wife's passing from and his own challenges facing this disease left not a dry eye in this place a few years ago. And while my interest was driven by my former employee, Nicky McManus, whose mum sadly passed from pancreatic cancer, this evening I would like to pay special tribute to Mark McCall. It'll come as no surprise to anyone that knows me that I'm all things safety in this Parliament, and I hosted the Scottish Community Safety Network event earlier this year. And Mark helped start Fife Council's Safer Communities team in 2016. He was the director of the Scottish Community Safety Network, and his leadership and expertise made a lasting impact on safety policies and his colleagues in this area. Mark sadly passed away in September after a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer, and the tributes that poured in for Mark show the enormous impact he had on his community. His legacy will last, and I thank him for his wonderful contribution. And we have Mark's family here tonight. So Claudette, Ross, Jordan, Amy and Sarah, you are very welcome. Indeed, to the entire gallery this evening, thank you to you all. You stand out as some of the most dedicated and knowledgeable and tenacious campaigners I have worked with. It is through your tenacity that we have made strides in raising the policy profile of this devastating disease, and we have gotten pancreatic cancer on the national agenda. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister for their engagement in the areas that we have raised over the years. But public awareness of the symptoms remains concerningly low. That is why Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month is as important as ever. Early diagnosis is crucial, we know that, and we speak every year on the need for early intervention. The message cannot get lost. The following statistics show the challenge we still face and why this debate is so needed. According to Pancreatic Cancer UK, less than 20% of people with pancreatic cancer are diagnosed at an early stage. 7 in 10 people with pancreatic cancer will never receive any treatment, and only 1 in 10 will receive surgery. Around half of pancreatic cancer patients visit their GP with symptoms at least 3 times before being referred to hospital, while 16% visit their GP 7 times or more before receiving a correct diagnosis. According to Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland's October survey, 62% of people in Scotland know almost nothing about pancreatic cancer. Meanwhile, 2/3 of the people in the UK cannot name a single symptom. So I want to remind people of what symptoms to look for. Common symptoms include back pain, indigestion, tummy pain, and unexplained weight loss or a loss of appetite. Anyone with jaundice, yellowing of the eyes or skin, should immediately go to A&E. Research commissioned by Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland found that a new diagnosis of diabetes not associated with weight gain can occur 1 to 3 years before a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer. With 30% of pancreatic cancer patients presenting with new onset diabetes before their diagnosis of the cancer, we have a potential to diagnose 270 more patients a year at an earlier stage. As Pancreatic Cancer UK has exemplified with their new No Time to Wait campaign, people cannot afford for a late wait and have a late diagnosis. For context, Scotland's 5-year survival rate is just 4.6%. Those diagnosed in time for potential life-saving surgery have a 5-year survival rate of around 30%. With early intervention, people can be diagnosed, live longer, and have a better quality of life. Presiding Officer, Scotland is leading on this. I have spoken before about the work of Precision Panc in Glasgow, and my colleagues will highlight some of that good work. And I have the pleasure to continue to work with Linda Murray, whose father, Mr. Begley, died from pancreatic cancer, and she keeps me abreast of the progress of the work of Ross Carter and his colleagues in the Pancreatic Hepatocellular Cancer Pathway Improvement Project, CHCC, PIP for short. This commenced phase one of rollout earlier this year, and I understand the first referrals have been already received, and planning continues for phase two rollout, which will be confirmed for Monday, the 5th of December. However, the challenges exist. The Royal College of Radiographers warns us that without immediate measures to grow pancreatic cancer workforce, treatment success and patient care will be compromised. And we know that the infrastructure of the health service is under pressure, and we have fewer scanners in the UK than most comparable countries in the OECD. More generally, getting the right support is crucial. And Pancreatic Cancer UK is a team of specialists and pancreatic cancer nurses. But only 125 people called this helpline from Scotland last year. The third sector is vital, but it cannot be a panacea for support, and I'm grateful that we have successive health secretaries who have listened and understood these challenges. Pancreatic cancer is uniquely aggressive and its survival rates are tragically low, but investment in addressing has increased since we've been having these debates 6 years ago. So, Presiding Officer, we need to continue to raise public awareness of the symptoms and impact of pancreatic cancer, and we need to consider how current policy deals with this cancer. Finally, UK pancreatic cancer represents 20% of cancer deaths in the UK. However, it only receives 3% of all research funding. Our engagement on these issues is absolutely essential, and I thank the Minister, Marie Todd, and Cabinet Secretary Humber Yousaf and all my parliamentary colleagues who visited the drop-in hosted by Pancreatic Cancer UK earlier this month. People and families behind these figures are counting on us to listen, but more to act. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Adamson. We move to the open debate. I call Sue Webber to be followed by Gillian Martin. Around 4 minutes, Ms Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Claire Adamson for bringing this debate to the Chamber this evening and for her speech that was full of emotion, bringing some harsh realities to the Chamber as well of this disease, but is also full of hope. And can I also thank the members of public that are in the gallery that have taken the time to come this evening to hear us speak. November is Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, and I welcome the chance to speak in this debate to show my support. It's a fantastic chance for the pancreatic cancer community to come together to raise awareness, funds, and also to remember loved ones who have sadly died of this disease. 10,000 people across the UK are diagnosed each year, yet only 1 in 4 people diagnosed survive beyond a year. Pancreatic cancer is the deadliest form of cancer in Scotland, with around 900 people dying of the disease each year in Scotland. Over half of those diagnosed will die within 3 months, and only 7% will survive more than 5 years. My life before this chamber allowed me unparalleled access to the surgical treatment of this deadly cancer. I worked alongside upper GI surgical consultants across the country, and I know firsthand of the complex nature of the surgery needed to treat pancreatic cancer. These are very much specialist surgeons that are committed to adopting innovative techniques to reduce surgical operative time, even by the slightest margins, and to seek new ways to reduce risk, surgical risk and post-operative complications. These all serve to make survival and survival rates better and these lives as livable as possible. They all work collaboratively across the NHS to do all they can to increase the five-year survival of their patients, but the outcomes following the potentially life-saving surgery are still a long way from being acceptable. There has barely been any improvement in pancreatic cancer survival rates in the last 50 years, and the survival gap between pancreatic and other cancers has doubled in the last 50 years, whilst the likelihood of surviving other cancers beyond 5 years is 50% for pancreatic cancer, it is just 7%. There can be no progress without change, and the need to improve pancreatic cancer diagnosis and outcomes in Scotland is urgent. Pancreatic cancer, after all, is the fifth biggest cancer killer in the UK. However, as Claire Adamson has rightly said, it only receives 3% of the annual UK cancer research budget. Raising awareness is key because two-thirds of people in the UK cannot name a single symptom of this cancer. Pancreatic Action Cancer Scotland completed a national awareness survey in October with some concerning results, where they found that only 62% of people in Scotland know almost nothing about pancreatic cancer. Pancreatic cancer has vague and non-specific symptoms and lacks a simple test for detection. This is what makes it hard to diagnose. And unfortunately, around half of pancreatic cancer patients visit their GP with their symptoms three times before being referred to hospital. And while these stats paint a bleak picture of the disease, with early diagnosis, pancreatic cancer can be survived. For those diagnosed in time for potential life-saving surgery, five-year survival increases to around 30%. This presents an opportunity for intervention where people can be diagnosed earlier and live longer with a far better quality of life. And such a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer can affect every aspect of life, bringing emotional, financial and practical problems that can last long after the treatment ends. So, if you are in a position and are listening to this debate today, can I take this chance to direct you to the practical, emotional and financial support from Macmillan Cancer Support, and as a first step, call their telephone line, Macmillan Support Line, 0808 808 0000, 7 days a week, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m, or please go to their website for help. And again, I would like to reinforce the thanks to Claire Adamson for bringing this debate before Parliament and helping raise the awareness of pancreatic cancer. Thank you, Claire.
Thank you very much, Ms Weber. I now call Gillian Martin to be followed by Carol Mauch in around 4 minutes, Ms Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too want to thank Claire Addison for securing this debate. I think it's 6 consecutive debates on pancreatic cancer that she's led, and her dedication to this cause helps us, gives us the chance in the chamber to raise awareness of the symptoms of this terrible disease, which, as we've heard from others, has been so crucial to catch early. And last year in the debate, I said that I'm always aware that when we read out the statistics on pancreatic cancer, that there will be people watching at home or indeed in the gallery who may have just received a diagnosis, be in treatment, or as close to someone who is. And ahead of this year's debate, I spoke to my constituent, Christine Wilson, who's currently undergoing some treatment for pancreatic cancer. Christine wasn't well enough to make it to the parliamentary event that Claire Adamson hosted a couple of weeks ago, so we had a Zoom call instead. And at the point of last year's debate, she was undiagnosed, and she's urged me to relay the message that continuous and strong public messaging around the symptoms is absolutely vital, because Christine was one of those people that didn't know what her symptoms were, and one of those people that went to the doctor repeatedly and had other diagnoses before they actually hit on the right one. And in our conversation, she made it the point that one of the reasons why her back and stomach pain wasn't identified as pancreatic cancer was because she didn't fit the profile. And her cancer was thought to be actually something else related to digestion. And I've heard this quite a few times when I've been speaking to colleagues from Pancreatic Cancer UK. And the fact is that anyone can get pancreatic cancer. So Christine and I are putting out a press release after this debate so that we can jointly get that message out to our local media. And she said that if there's one thing that she wants to do is to let others know what to look out for. And she says that if publicising her story can help others know the symptoms, then something positive can come out of this. And I'm happy to help her to do that in any way that I can. And pancreatic cancer have also produced, and I hope the presiding officer will forgive me for using the prop, but they've produced this wallet-sized leaflet which details the symptoms. And last week, some of our colleagues from PCUK and I had a little chat with Marie Todd, the minister, about putting links to PCUK on NHS and forums so that those with a diagnosis can get in touch with them for the immediate support, which is especially important for those that for whom surgical options are too late. And so, to Christine, I promise that I do what I can today to raise awareness of the symptoms that could be pancreatic cancer so that anyone who had them, like Christine, could have a better idea of what they mean or what they could mean and to go to the doctor with that in mind. And that's how I'm going to end my contribution. It's repeating what Claire Adamson has already said, but that's the whole point of this. We need to repeat what these symptoms are. Please get yourself to the GP if you have any of these symptoms. If your back or stomach hurts, it could be that tumour is pushing against nerves or organs near the pancreas and blocking the digestive tract. Similarly, if you feel bloated, get it checked because pancreatic cancer may cause gas, bloating or a build-up of fluid in the abdomen. A loss of appetite, indigestion or nausea are common with people who have pancreatic cancer, as is constipation or diarrhea. And if you're losing weight and you don't know why, it could be because cancer is causing your body to burn more calories than usual. And finally, if your skin and eyes look yellow, it could be jaundice caused by a tumour. It might be blocking the bile duct that should flow from the gallbladder to the small intestine. Presiding officer, the message from Christine is clear. Don't stay silent if you have any of those symptoms. And I want to thank Christine for taking the time to talk to me today about her story. And like her, I hope at least one person today maybe watches this debate, listens to all of us, and acts on the advice that we're given and will be able to get life-saving treatment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Martin. And I call Carol Mochan to be followed by Willie Coffey again. 4 minutes, Ms Martin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also thank Claire Adamson for bringing this debate to the Chamber and to those joining us in the gallery. Welcome. On behalf of Scottish Labour, can I mark Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month and also World Pancreatic Cancer Day, which took place, as we have heard earlier this month. Raising awareness of illness such as pancreatic cancer is absolutely pivotal to ensuring early diagnosis and improving prognosis, as we have heard. Indeed, like I did last year, Deputy Presiding Officer, and as others have done, I consider it important to highlight in the Chamber that key symptoms of pancreatic cancer, including abdominal or back pain or discomfort, unexplained weight loss or a loss of appetite, yellowing of the skin or eyes, and or itchy skin, change in bowel habits, nausea or vomiting, and indigestion that does not respond to treatment. Knowing these symptoms and seeking medical advice, if we've heard, even as a precaution, can be life-saving or life-prolonging, and it is key that we continue to support the public awareness campaigns, as many other members have said today. I also want to just mention our NHS, Deputy Presiding Officer. We cannot avoid the fact that we have here in Scotland an NHS that is not always working for patients and staff. An NHS that was founded to be universal, free at the point of need and accessible is now struggling through no fault of our first-class workforce to survive on a daily basis. We can't fill vacancies, and I think that we need to be more honest and talk about the reality for patients, families and staff as we face this. As I said, I don't want to labour that point particularly, but I do want to talk about the reality of inequality in health in Scotland today. In this same debate around this time last year, Deputy Presiding Officer, I warned that the Scottish Government must do more to tackle the widespread health inequalities which to this day remain a stain on our society and adversely impact those from our most deprived areas. The reality is that the Government does not show enough urgency in dealing with this problem. Research released by Cancer Research this week has highlighted that people living in deprived areas in Scotland are more likely to get cancer and, tragically, are more likely to die. It highlighted that cancer death rates are a devastating 74% higher in the most deprived populations than the least deprived populations. And, Deputy Presiding Officer, the research confirms that there are lower 1 and 5 year survival rates amongst the most deprived groups. This is the reality of those in Scotland's poorest communities, and we should all be shocked by this. It is right that we have these debates, and often in this very consensual manner that we do during members' debates. But I would urge the Minister in her closing remarks this evening and ask her, will she commit to coming to the Chamber during government time to set out a clear plan for what has already become a crisis in health inequalities in Scotland today? Deputy Presiding Officer, we must take action to address the health inequalities facing our country linked to cancer. The most recent Public Health Scotland data confirms that pancreatic cancer remains in the top 10 most common cancers amongst men and women. And therefore, overall, but as the motion states, it is in the deadliest of the common cancers. And if nothing else, this should encourage serious and prompt action. In concluding, Deputy Presiding Officer, it is important that we take the opportunity this evening to highlight the symptoms of pancreatic cancer and to encourage everyone with even a slightest doubt or concern to seek medical advice. It could be life-saving. However, in this chamber, as members, elected members, it is the decisions that we make that can save lives. It is the decisions and radical and determined fight against health inequalities that can make a difference. And I urge the chamber to have time to debate this further. Thank you again to Claire Adamson for bringing the debate to the Chamber, and to those who came to the gallery, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mochen. I now call Willie Coffey to be followed by Miles Briggs for in 4 minutes. Mr Coffey.
Presiding Officer, thank you, and once again congratulations to my colleague Claire Adamson for bringing the subject of pancreatic cancer to the Chamber. Claire has been a strong advocate on this subject for a number of years now, and her continuing endeavour is much appreciated. We probably all have our own stories to tell about this difficult cancer, and my own family's experience of it dates back to 1985, when my mother died from the disease. Taken far too early at the age of 53, there's never a day goes by where the family don't think about her. And this debate helps me too, Presiding Officer, to keep her with me from day to day. My last speech, though, on this was in 2020, and I wonder if more members recall that very moving speech made by John Scott, our colleague who thankfully recovered his own health at that time after a long illness. It's those powerful contributions that help us to get the message out to the Scottish people about the current work going on and the real hope that progress is being made in the fight against this cancer. The stats are challenging, to say the least, with a much lower survival rate than most other cancers. It's not the most common cancer in Scotland, ranking about 12th in the list, but it climbs up that table, sadly, in terms of deaths that it causes. And that's why more work needs to be done to fight it. And the new 10-year cancer strategy will surely focus its attention on this most deadly of all the cancers that we have to worry about and help us drive up those survival rates. The ability to spot the symptoms early is always important, as are the rapid cancer diagnosis pilots operating in 3 health board areas in Scotland, and which are showing that 12% of patients received an early cancer diagnosis, including pancreatic cancer, in the crucial fight against the disease. The current evaluation is showing that these pilots are a useful way of ruling in or out cancer for patients with non-specific symptoms. And this, as Pancreatic Cancer UK says, could be life-changing for pancreatic cancer patients. Early diagnosis can save your life. As ever, Presiding Officer, there is some great work going on in the research field, with Scotland leading the way in some of the innovative approaches being undertaken. The Glasgow Cancer Centre uses patient biopsies to collect information that can be used to direct treatment of clinical trials that are personalised to that individual. Precision Panc, that Claire Adamson mentioned, we mentioned it in the debate a couple of years ago too, Presiding Officer, is led by a team at Glasgow University and is a collaborative endeavour that focuses on uncovering the molecular profile of people and matching this up to the most effective clinical trials for them. And Pancreatic Cancer UK is collaborating with the Beatson Institute to fund 5 PhD students to work on the disease as part of their Future Leaders Academy. One other piece of work being done by the Institute of Cancer Research that sounds really interesting to me, presiding officer, is something called gremlin therapy. Not easy to follow, but apparently the presence of the gremlin protein has been demonstrated to reverse the fate of the dangerous cells in the body. And working alongside another chemical that regulates the amount of this protein, these two molecules work hand in hand to create something called a self-inhibitory feedback loop that has been shown to restrict cancer spread to only 15% of the test samples. What's even more interesting, perhaps, presiding officer, is that this modelling was first predicted by none other than the computer science genius Alan Turing. So there is great hope that this therapy can bear fruit. In summary, presiding officer, we all know this is one of the hardest cancers to fight, but I'm encouraged to read about the current work going on in Scotland and across the world to try and tackle it. The research is exciting. Early results are positive, so let's hope that this work ultimately makes a difference and helps deliver the breakthrough we need against what is one of the most dangerous cancers that we face. And finally, congratulations again to Claire Adamson for bringing the subject to the attention of the Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Coffey. I now call Miles Briggs, to be followed by Marie McNair, again, around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking Claire Adamson as well for bringing this debate forward again this year. It's really very welcome that members can contribute. And can I also welcome to the public gallery all the guests we have. You're very welcome, and it's great to see so many who have been campaigning for so long, very much campaigned for us to make sure we continue to have these debates, and I think that's important. And like Willie Coffey said, and Sue Webber as well, I think this debate is now really a really important one in the parliamentary diary to present an opportunity for us all to remember those who we have lost to this disease, but also those who have lived. And I think that's also important that we register that. And I'd thank colleagues for the kind words they've said about my former MSP colleague, John Scott. He was in Parliament just a couple of weeks ago with his grandchildren and is well and enjoying life outside of politics, which is maybe a lesson for all of us, to be quite honest. But it was good to see him. And I know certainly he follows these debates as well. And I wanted to touch upon some of the information which was provided to me during the drop-in session, which was held a couple of weeks ago on the 17th, during Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, because here in my own region, Cancer Region of the South East Scotland, there were 251 people diagnosed in 2020 through our cancer network. And statistically, it is a grim situation when you look at an average of only 27.3% of people with pancreatic cancer surviving more than a year from that diagnosis. Now, that is what we need to focus all our thoughts on. And yesterday, as Carol Mockin pointed towards, I co-chaired the Scottish Cancer Conference along with Jackie Bailey. And it is, I think, one of the most shocking reports I've ever sort of read and seen, and it is specifically, again, a purple prop. Sorry, Deputy Presiding Officer, but deprivation and cancer inequalities in Scotland. I hope everyone has a chance to read this document across the Parliament, because it really shows the need for an emergency response to where cancer services are in Scotland. I welcome the work which is currently taking place around the Scottish Government's National Cancer Strategy, but it really overlaps with what we've been calling for many years with regards to pancreatic cancer, and that is around real investment in our rapid diagnosis and decision around to treat pathways, which is something we all need to see improvement on. Now, I wanted to close on a positive note, because I was delighted to visit the Precision Panc project at the Beatson a few years ago, just before the pandemic. And ahead of this debate, I reached out to find out what work has been going on, because I think it is important to recognise that amazing achievement which is taking place here in Scotland at this moment in time, because there's been 32 recruitment centres put in place. I believe 500 patients are now registered. 300 patients have now been able to progress to clinical trials. Those trials, I think, to date are all up to Primus 008 is currently coming forward, 006 and 008, sorry, over the next 3 to 6 months. So we're making welcome steps forward on this. And I think one of the information, bits of information I was told, that biopsy for pancreatic cancer has now become the norm as well, which I think is incredibly important and welcome when you speak to patients, which, you know, so often people would just progressing to a palliative pathway without any investigation. I think what's important is that we're also seeing the molecular profiling of pancreatic cancer and now becoming a reality in the NHS as well. But there's two challenges I think I want to close on, and that specifically is around research, because we know there needs to be a sustained need for more investment, and for pharmaceutical partners as well to be part of that, to make sure that pancreatic cancer is a disease they are investing in as well. And I hope, and on the back of this debate, ministers, as they look towards the National Cancer Strategy, will really be looking at this. We need to see pancreatic cancer given a priority within rapid diagnosis and decision-making pathways to treat, because we're still not where we need to be as a country on that. And that is what each and every one of us should be challenging the government on. And certainly from the conversations I had yesterday at the Scottish Cancer Conference, that is what the sector wants to see, and we all should be working towards that. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Briggs. I now call Marie McNair again, around 4 minutes. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by congratulating Claire Adamson for securing this debate and for her excellent opening speech made with compassion. It is important that we take this opportunity to not only recognise Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, but strive to improve the response to this dreadful disease. I use this debate to ensure the voices of my constituents impacted by pancreatic cancer are heard in this chamber. My constituent Anne-Marie Adams and her mother Margaret have travelled through from Clydebank to support today's debate, and I welcome them both here today. Anne-Marie's husband, Billy, passed peacefully this year on the 17th of June, just 2 months after his diagnosis. He was surrounded by his loving family, who had to cope with losing him at 55 years of age. Billy was a born and bred Bankie, working in security in pubs within his local area. A diehard Liverpool and Glasgow Warrior fan, he'd hoped to visit his beloved Anfield before he died. Unfortunately, he didn't get the chance. However, Anne-Marie and her mum did visit Anfield at the start of this month to mark Billy's 56th birthday on the 8th of November and to scatter some of his ashes in the River Mersey. Anne-Marie feels the general public and health practitioners alike need to be more aware of the signs and symptoms of pancreatic cancer to enable a quicker diagnosis. Also, her experiences have convinced her of the need for enhanced end-of-life care and support. Better communication and streamlined services are essential to help those impacted to enable them to use the time they have left to greatest effect. Unfortunately for Billy, his cancer was too far advanced to receive treatment. Anne-Marie wants everything to be done to prevent other families facing the same heartache. I welcome another of my constituents, Katie Henry from Mulgay, who is watching online. She also wants more awareness of this terrible disease to which she lost her grandmother. Christine sadly passed away on the 25th of June 2021 at the age of 79, leaving behind her husband of 57 years, Bill, her three children, five grandchildren and two grand dogs. Christine was a retired primary school teacher who loved singing in rock choirs, with her favourite number being Dancing Queen by ABBA. She was a devoted grandmother and had a large network of friends, always managing to make people feel special whilst in her company. Christine was back and forth to her GP, who eventually referred her to hospital for tests. She was tested in December 2020 for bowel cancer, which came back clear. Christine continued to feel unwell, and knowing that something was not quite right, decided to go private for a scan. This detected a shadow on her pancreas. Further tests were carried out, with Christine eventually being diagnosed with pancreatic cancer on the 26th of March 2021. Christine's ashes were scattered in Mugdock Country Park and on the beach in Anstruther. These were places she enjoyed visiting, having happy times there with her family. Her granddaughter Katie would like increased funding, better scanner capacity, quicker referrals from doctors, clinical trials, person-centred care and more research. It is an honour on behalf of my constituents to share their heartbreaking experiences with Parliament. I pay tribute to their strength and determination to highlight how important early diagnosis is to saving lives. We know that this is one of the deadliest cancer forms, with 900 people dying each year in Scotland, and yet two-thirds of people in the UK can't name a single symptom of pancreatic cancer. So we must do more to get the message out there that the symptoms and ensure that it's given the correct response in the new cancer strategy for Scotland. I also praise Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland and Pancreatic Cancer UK for everything they do to raise awareness of their support for today's event. The powerful testimonies from my constituents must drive us on to do everything we can to get the best possible answer to the dreadful impact of pancreatic cancer. We must show that we have listened and ensure that the response to this cancer gets the priority it deserves. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. I now invite Marie Todd to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I would like to thank Claire Adamson for raising this motion in the Chamber today and for my colleagues' important contributions. In addition, I want to thank Pancreatic Cancer UK for their continued efforts in both raising awareness of pancreatic cancer and in supporting pancreatic cancer patients. I did attend the parliamentary drop-in a couple of weeks ago and I was really delighted to see just how many members from across this chamber were engaging with the event. I have to say, as ever, this now annual event has been very powerful today. It's always a pleasure to have the stories of the citizens of Scotland brought to life in this chamber and to have people visiting for whom it is so meaningful, the debate that we have. It really is the Scottish Parliament at its best, and I too welcome the friends and families and volunteers and workers from Pancreatic Cancer UK. At the event a couple of weeks ago, I had a chance to speak to a few of the employees of the charity and their volunteers who have, many of them have their own personal experience with pancreatic cancer. These individual stories are so impactful, just as we've heard today. The personal stories, and it's through these testimonies that we can identify where we can improve services further. From my conversations a couple of weeks ago, patient information remains an issue when a patient is diagnosed, and we know that it can be really difficult for an individual to understand all of the information that's provided as they're processing the initial diagnosis. And it's so important that we provide resources for patients, not just at the beginning of their cancer diagnosis, but throughout their treatment pathway. That's why the Scottish Government's piloting 12 programmes across Scotland. That programme is for single point of contact. That programme sets out to ensure that all patients will have a constant point of contact throughout their cancer pathway to continually refer back to, rather than needing to make new contacts as they go along their testing, treatment and post-treatment support. That single point of contact will ensure that patients are receiving timely and accurate advice on their appointments, their tests and their results. Mm-hmm. And it will offer the opportunity to discuss the non-clinical support that's available and to help patients to self-manage some aspects of their condition. But not only is it crucial to have the information throughout a patient's pathway, it is also crucial to ensure that there is an awareness of pancreatic cancer before they've even been diagnosed, as many have mentioned in the chamber. So we're all aware in this chamber that November is Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, and raising awareness of pancreatic cancer and its common symptoms, back pain, yellowing skin, indigestion, tummy pain and weight loss, is absolutely crucial in detecting this cancer early. We know that the earlier that cancer is detected, the easier it is to treat, and that's why we continue to invest in our Detect Cancer Early programme, which takes a whole systems approach to early detection and encompasses primary care, secondary care, public awareness, data and screening. an overarching Detect Cancer Early, I think I'll just call it DCE now, we do love these acronyms, social marketing campaign Survivors, was developed in close consultation with the other Scottish Cancer Coalition, and that includes Pancreatic Charity Representation in 2018. The campaign aimed to reduce the fear around cancer and empower people to take early action. To coincide with the campaign, an interactive tool was developed on DCE's website, getcheckedearly.org, to raise awareness of the early signs and symptoms of cancer, including pancreatic. And a new DCE awareness campaign is under development and will launch in spring next year. And I would encourage any individual who might be experiencing common symptoms of cancer to present to their GP. As committed to in our NHS recovery plan, work's underway through the Centre for Sustainable Deliveries Earlier Cancer Diagnosis Programme Board to develop a new earlier cancer diagnosis vision, and that will form part of Scotland's new cancer strategy expected in spring 2023. Extensive engagement's been undertaken to date to develop our next cancer strategy. Our consultation analysis has been published, which pulls out a number of key themes and priority areas for the government to consider. Pancreatic cancer, as one of the less survivable cancers, has yet again been highlighted as an area of need. And we've previously highlighted less survivable cancers through our National Cancer Plan and have focused a number of our actions and investment in this area. Notably, we're working with the Scottish Hepatopancreatobiliary, I'll call that HPB network, to improve pathways across pancreatic and liver cancers. We've invested £653,000 of funding to that network over two financial years to redesign these cancer pathways. And that work is aimed to improve patient outcomes and experience. And like everyone in this chamber, I absolutely look forward to us making the technological advances that are required, particularly in early diagnosis, because far too many people, as we have heard today, have advanced cancer at the point that they receive a diagnosis. Now, a number of members mentioned the Cancer Research UK report on inequalities, which was published yesterday. CAB Secretary Hamza Youssef attended that conference and did a short speech, and he then took a Q&A. He also met with the CRUK Chief Executive afterwards to discuss it in more detail. We do continue to tackle disparities in deprived areas by ensuring that there's equitable access to cancer services via our National Cancer Plan. The new 10-year strategy launching in spring next year will take a comprehensive approach to improving patient pathways from prevention and diagnosis through to treatment and post-treatment care. But I'm always aware when I discuss health inequalities, as we do many times in this chamber, that there is a level of complexity involved in how poverty impacts on health. People who live in poverty are more likely to get cancer in the first place. We know that they're more likely to smoke and they're more likely to be obese. Those are the two biggest risk factors for cancer. They're more likely to have a later diagnosis. And I heard a patient advocate speak very powerfully on the radio yesterday, a man called Ali, who is a fireman, who had worked his whole life with people from socioeconomically deprived communities. And he talked about the difficulties in accessing healthcare and the difficulties in being listened to. There is less uptake of screening. We have a huge programme of work invested in that to try to ensure that people who are living in poverty take up the offers of screening. Cervical cancer, for example, if screening is taken up, will prevent cancer. It doesn't just detect it early, it catches it before it's even cancer. Poverty, in reality, kills, and we're doing much in this Parliament to tackle poverty, but as mentioned many times before, not all the levers are in our hands. We are tackling poverty from the Scottish Child Payment, promoting the real living wage. There's a raft of initiatives around. I suppose to sum up on the issue of health inequalities are complex. They do relate from wealth inequalities, but they're also about status inequalities and about inequalities in power. and a cultural shift is required to tackle those. And again, you see work going on within the Scottish NHS to ensure that we have person-centred care, realistic medicine, shared decision-making, all of these things designed to empower people who come through our system. The Scottish Government is very clear in its commitment to improving cancer awareness. We've continued to prioritise cancer services throughout the pandemic, and we'll continue to do so as we recover and head into this winter period. It's absolutely crucial that we continue to raise awareness of cancer symptoms, particularly amongst those less survivable cancers like pancreatic. And I want to thank everyone who is helping us to do so. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.